Good to your seat. Get back, gnashing teeth. Ooh.
I want all Rose Byrne launched a Dollhouse Collective, an all-female production company. Meryl Streep funded a writer's lab for women over 40. It seems like things are skyrocketing for women in the entertainment industry, right? I am Kanza Khan, and you are listening to episode 3 of the Exposé, where we are going to show you that beneath all of these advances lurks just as much sexism as there ever was. Before we dive in, I have two announcements to make. Firstly, a correction. In last episode's concluding statements, I noted that we played a song by musician Janae Aiko, but I pronounced her first name as Jean. My apologies to Janae Aiko for this mispronunciation. Secondly, I am so excited to welcome Laila Alawa as my new co-host.
Hey everyone, I'm Laila Alawa. I'm so pumped to be a part of this. So Kanza and I conducted two separate interviews for this episode. The first was with Aizzah Fatima, an actor and writer best known for her one-woman play called Dirty Packy Lingerie. Along with Aizzah, we spoke to Iman Zawahry, an independent producer and director who's working with Aizzah to develop a film version of Dirty Packy Lingerie.
We would also like to issue a brief disclaimer. This episode does contain some language.
You've been warned. The first interview you're going to hear is Aizzah and Iman's.
Aizzah and Iman, welcome. Thank you guys so much for coming onto the show. We are so glad to have you guys here. Why don't we start off with a very simple question. What pushed you guys to enter the entertainment industry?
I think for me, knowing that the stories in the play are, you know, stories of real people, and what pushes me forward is just telling their truth and sharing it with the world. And I think those are important stories to tell.
Your show is called Dirty Packy Lingerie, which is a controversial title. What kind of reaction did you get from the community?
So a lot of communities are very receptive to the title, and they're like, great, bring it, we want it because of the title. Now that I am trying to reach the Muslim community more, so I've been doing a college tour this last year or so, and when I go to a college through a Muslim student organization, the MSA, and the president is a woman, the show gets in. And when it's a guy, the reception is very cold, and usually it never pans out. I have never once been brought over by an MSA where the president of the MSA was a man, or, you know, a college student. I'm waiting for the day somebody proves me wrong, and a male, president of an MSA invites the show over.
So is your audience predominantly female then?
No, not really. I mean, again, it's very mixed. It's really theater-going people, right? But now I'm really making an effort because I think it's just as important for women to discuss these issues within the Muslim American communities here as well as men.
All right, Iman, so you are a female director and a producer. Are there moments where you just feel like you are fighting the battle for every Muslim woman?
Yes, it is very exhausting every single day of my life. I think that's for any hijab, but it's funny because sometimes I always say, like, you know, I feel like if I wasn't a filmmaker, maybe I wouldn't wear hijab anymore. Like, I always, like, make that comment, but I'm like, damn it, I gotta fight this fight. Like, that's, like, the kind of idea, like, creating this image is very important to me, and I'm gonna be your representation. Not like I'm a martyr or anything, but I'm very American, I'm very outgoing, I'm very outspoken. I do a lot of different things, like, I teach Zumba, and then I teach university, and I, you know, like, I do a bunch of different things, and I think it's a great representation of regular people and Muslims, you know, so it is really exhausting because I just want to be like, you know, can I just, you know, and I have some faults sometimes, you know, but you can never have faults
right.
when you're constantly being representative of the people. And I think that's not just me, I think it's any woman in any occupation that they're in.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's extremely exhausting. You definitely don't see Pakistani women on film, and you don't see hijabi on film, right? That just doesn't happen. And these are things that we need to push. And then, I mean, I feel confident with, you know, Aizzah's Nye's resume that it's strong enough to create a strong narrative. Putting the finances are very, very important.
Honestly, I think as artists, you know, the talent is always there. And for a lot of artists, finances are what the hard part is. I think we have a lot of rich doctors and lawyers and whatnot within our communities. And I think what we now need is those people to help artists in a financial way, because, I mean, this is one of the things that we're dealing with right now in terms of, right. we've been working on this feature film, and we're in the process of fundraising right now. And I mean, I have to say the Muslim community, of course, has been amazing, and we're actually in the middle of fundraising right now as we speak. So all of our funders so far have been Muslim people, and that's great, but I think we need a lot more of that, because there are still a lot of people within the Muslim communities who don't think are valuable enough. I think there's still that mindset amongst maybe some of the older generation, right, that it's not valuable enough. So what are you doing with your life?
You know, we're going to talk to these Muslims that are doctors and everything, and we're putting our whole, like, pitch and whole outline out there, but they're always very reserved to be able to give us something, right? Because I've heard from, you know, my family members, you know, they're like, why would I give money to you when people in Syria are dying? And I'm like, okay, so they're you know, they're not mutually exclusive. We can do both. Speaking of that, I helped. I'm like one of the co-creators of the first Islamic scholarship fund with the grant. So we created it last year, and the whole goal of creating it is that, like, we wanted to be able to give, first of all, create strong firm narratives, and to be able to make these stories. Of course, it's not a huge amount, right? But it's enough to where if someone wanted to create a story and they needed funds for it, then we're there for them. Like, this is the first of its kind. And there should be, like, you know, 100 of these. And it is kind of frustrating that we have to be pioneers. It's awesome at the same time because we're creating this, but we are the pioneers of our generations of creating these things for Muslim artists.
That's awesome.
I remember one time I was talking to a man and I was getting so frustrated. I was like, where is my Shonda Rhimes? That is what we need a Shonda Rhimes for Muslims. And the man just looked at me and she's like, Aizzah, we have to be it. We have to be our own Shonda Rhimes right now because we don't have one. We have to, you know, make ourselves get to that level. And I think it's happening. There's very few of us, but it's so sad because we know everybody who is sort of in this field. We know all the Muslim people out there pretty much, or we've heard of them. You know, we're doing this because there's still such few.
Yeah, I mean, such few women in general, too. I think, like, there are tons of women who are trying to get in, but not too many can make it.
So, are your goals to kind of take over mainstream media, or do you feel that there's a potential to create your own line of media? Because there's a conversation among minority groups, be it ethnic or racial groups, women, whatever, to create media independently instead of going to large studios.
My idea of film is to produce, not a studio film, so it would be independent film, but to be picked up by a studio independent. Very similar, like, my goal is to be like My Big Fat Greek Wedding or Bennett Like Beckham. So where it hits distributors in the festival market, and it just kind of blew up because the story is different and all the characters are not white males.
What's up with women being portrayed as meat in the media?
Well, look, I think as long as men are telling stories, they're going to tell the stories that they want to see. So we need more women telling these stories, and we need to tell our own stories, right? Whether you're a woman or belong to any other minority group, we need to tell our own stories. We need more storytellers, period. And that's how you combat that.
Very good point. That's such a good point. No woman is going to do that. Like, I mean, that's just not how it works.
Right. Let me actually, in regards to that, there's been very sexist casting calls for women, and I'm just going to read some to you guys right now. Okay, seeking female, 51 to 60 years, Hispanic, stereotypical Spanish housekeeper. The role will be comedic and original. Don't worry. Another one. I don't know what that means.
Don't worry.
Yeah, so.
Just in case you didn't know.
Yeah, just in case.
That's great.
There's mid-30s, Caucasian, high-strung brunette, accomplished and driven, yet feminine. Must be okay with a tastefully shot gang rape, along with performing 19th century dance.
Oh my god. Wow, that's such an interesting combination. I want to know.
I can do all of it. You know, it's so interesting about
thinking so creatively. I love it.
And then the another
one. You know a man wrote that.
Yeah, exactly. And there's another one. It's Stunning Girl. This character is a replacement for other female character. If she is a 10, then this character is an 11. Will be wearing a small bikini for her part. Only has a few lines.
That is so embarrassing.
That's great.
You know, it, you know what's so sad about those too? I don't know if you have this either, but I know people that would be dying to do that. They're like, whatever, let me do it. I just want to get on television. I don't care. And it's right. So interesting because the first one that you read, the person obviously knows what they're writing is offensive because they have to say, don't worry, it's going to be creative. Like, come on, like, think about it.
Exactly. I mean, I just personally don't understand why women would even respond to blatantly sexist casting calls. Granted, yeah, you always obviously want to be on TV, but at what cost, though?
But you know what? Honestly, guys, I feel like we get so conditioned to think that that's not even sexist, right? I'm sure there are people who read that and never think twice about that being sexist. And they're like, okay, great, another role, let's do it. You know, so, I think, again, I mean, it's just going back to if we want to change something, I think we have to do it ourselves.
The second interview featured Cat Cooper, a UK-based producer and filmmaker who founded filmfeminist.org, and Lexi Alexander, an Oscar-nominated director and the only woman to have ever directed a Marvel film.
She directed Punisher: War Zone.
Yes, that's the one. Let's jump in. Kat and Lexi, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us. I want to start off really broad. What kind of sexism do you face from your male peers in the entertainment industry?
The sexism tends to be really subtle, and most of it masked as a joke or something that you're supposed to laugh at. The worst behavior that I've always noticed are the old school dinosaurs, who again tend to be quite high up. But what happens with those is their old school sexism and misogyny kind of seeps down, and they create this really uncomfortable, hostile environment around them, and everyone just becomes a part of that, whether they're old school festival programmers or, you know, whether they run a course or a school or whatever it is. I came into film as a teenager, and I thought, I'll put my head down and you get on with it, because that's the advice that, you know, people like to give. If you just do a good job, right, that's what you want to believe. You want to believe in this ideal world that if you just do a good job, that will be enough. I think what I found is that you can only do that for so long. You can only excuse so much for so long before you go, like, enough. And what happened with me when I started talking about my experiences, which I started doing after reading a book called Everyday Sexism by Laura Bates, which is now an international movement, really, of women shouting back about things that happen to them day to day. And as soon as I started talking, and Lexi's probably had an experience with this too, is actually as soon as you start voicing your opinion about things that are actually happening, you hear from so many women all around the world. I've heard from these women who are having exactly the same issues, but so many are afraid, paranoid, you know, of speaking up and speaking out. And I found when I set up a website called Film Feminist that I still to this day have more emails sitting in my inbox than I have on the site, because women want you to know what is happening to them. But even with anonymity, they still don't feel like they can really put anything out there. But they don't want to jeopardize, you know, a career that they spend years investing time and commitment into, and years very often, where you start out for little to no money. I mean, it's depressing as hell, I won't lie, if you're sitting in a room committed to a career, a creative career that you're really passionate about, and it seeps through there, and you know, that's another part of the plan. And I don't think I will ever forget the day that I sat in a room of, I don't know, like maybe a dozen of us, equally split, guys and girls, and women were told explicitly as a piece of advice that we should marry rich girls.
Yeah, wow. And those people are supposed to be the ones encouraging you.
That's indicative. That's indicative of the kind of thing that you will hear, and it will be told. It's subtle. This kind of sexism is always subtle. It's funny, it's a joke, but you have to acknowledge it, you know. It's just so fucking miserable, is what I'm going to say.
Lexi, did you want to add to this?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we all experience it and all in different forms. Because I have so many of these tales, and I will identify it now as sexism, but until just a couple of years ago, I kind of was in denial or in some kind of bubble. I remember this famous story of a driver on this movie I did called Queen Street, made that in London, and a driver in a van has to take people from set to base camp where you have lunch. And it's extremely important that the director and the DP, like a core group, go really quickly because they have the first ones back on set. But this driver wouldn't take me. And I said, why aren't you driving? We have to go. And he said, I've been told to wait here until the director is in the car. And so my DP told him, but the director is here. She's the director. And the driver said, no, the director. And he couldn't comprehend in his head that I was directing this movie. It was only until I called in my kind of old geezer-looking first AD, who is like, you know, British geezer in his 60s, and I made him come in, and I said to him, tell him you're the director, and he said, what? And then finally the guy was driving by me pretending that somebody else is directing my movie. So those are the kind of things this was an extreme one, but these are the things that you experience constantly. It's either they don't want to believe it or they hate that you're directing this movie.
I remember being asked, or the first time I was invited to Cannes, I was really excited. Until the guy turned around and said I could go on the basis that I wore a really tight dress.
Oh my God.
So I said something rude and I didn't go to Cannes that time.
What pushed you to enter the film industry despite its notorious unfriendliness towards women?
I don't think you see it. Like, I don't think when you go in or you think about going in, you're even thinking about that. I wasn't.
I didn't either. I had no idea. I mean, it was also like Hollywood sells itself so liberal. And I'm telling you right now, they're probably worse than most right-wing Republican companies in terms of safety, because you don't see it coming.
But you guys never thought of leaving the industry even now?
Oh, yeah, I think of that every day. I mean, they're not letting me work. There's nothing really I can contribute. To be honest, the subtleness of the discrimination, which is not that really, some of the things are subtle, but there's actually daily abuse and discrimination, which after many years, I mean, it gets to you.
Aside from loving the medium, I think film has a responsibility, and Lexi, you've weighed the numbers before about, you know, the amount of hours people spend consuming media.
Yeah.
And we are sold this, you know, this world, and we want better representation in our work, and that's why I've decided to stick the course, because I want to see more diversity, I want more accessible stories. I mean, we've been talking about women generally in this conversation, but actually when you break down women, and I think I found a stat for the Oscars, you know, women on screen, 7.4% white, 11% black, 4% Latino, 4% Asian, 4% other, and I don't know what they were meaning by otherworldly, but there's a 3% otherworldly too. And you just, you know, we need better. If I have kids in this world, I want them to grow up seeing better stuff.
Yeah, that's very true. There's a whole issue about what we actually put on the screen. And, you know, none of it is going to change if we just keep the same frat boy dudes in charge.
Yeah, definitely.
So, Lexi, everyone thought you would have been a solid choice to direct the Wonder Woman film, but you have been very clear that you're not interested. I know you've spoken about this before, but could you explain why you made that decision?
Well, you know, it's funny that nobody catches on to this now that Michelle McLaren left, because I saw this coming from miles away, because it's a difficult situation to walk into. That doesn't mean she's difficult, and it doesn't even have to mean that the studio is difficult. It's the fact that there's a tremendous amount of pressure on the fact that Wonder Woman has been one of the most popular characters in the comic book world, you know, for many, many years, and people have been calling for this movie, and it hasn't happened. Over and over again, it was pushed back into the draw. So there's pressure to finally do it, to get it right. And there's pressure on the fact that there hasn't been any female superhero movies. So that's one kind of big chunk of weight that the guy who's doing Ant-Man probably doesn't feel, okay? But then there's the fact that you're a female director on a big studio pick, also something very rare, also all eyes on you. Everybody wants you to, you know, be successful, because as a director, you're not successful or failing individually, you're succeeding or failing for all women. And that's what I meant by saying, like, for me personally, it would be too much. I've been in a situation where I work on a studio film, and I know how it is, how much fear of failure there is. And when you make decisions out of fear, it's not a good creative situation. It looks like Michelle McLaren wanted to be sure she's making a great movie, knowing that making a bad movie is going to be incredibly bad for her career. So that's the reality of it. It's not a dream scenario for any woman to walk in there.
Yeah, no, I bet. I mean, that is a lot of pressure. Sometimes films don't do too well at the box office, and yet male directors that directed such films are still given big budget projects in the future, unlike their female counterparts. Do box office numbers allow male executives to justify not hiring women directors?
Well, definitely. There's a director's trail, and you land in their male and female, you know, you land in there after a box office done, but the sentences are incredibly different. For a man, it's like, okay, so a guy, you know, has a box office failure with a big action movie, and you know what his punishment is? Now you have to do two young adult movies that are major properties, okay, that we would love to get our fingers on, but they are literally sentences for men in director's jail, whereas our director's jail is like, we will try and never let you near a studio movie for the next 20 years or until you die. So, yeah, it's incredibly. It's the truth. Their punishment is they have to switch genres, whereas our punishment is basically we get haired and feathered out of town.
Oh my God, you're completely shunned, basically.
Yeah.
I think this would be a great place to bring up the study that you two brought up earlier. So this is the Female Filmmakers Initiative that is funded by the Sundance Institute and the Women in Film Los Angeles that explore the careers of female directors. I just want to get your reactions to it, the both of you. The study's qualitative findings looking at the impediments facing female directors included a perceived scarcity of female filmmakers, like a small pool to choose from. Women were also perceived as lacking ambition, and their competence was doubted.
Cat, do you want to go? No, you go first.
you get it from the director's point of view. My response to that is I'm not hugely surprised. The numbers are dreadful. They're embarrassing. They are, Melissa Silverstein said it, it's a crisis. It's shameful. There is no scarcity of these women. What we're short of are people who are going to put their hands in their pocket and spend money putting their work out. Lexi, you jump in. This is your field.
You know, it's upsetting. I am a director, and I'm shocked, to be honest, that this is part of what people believe, and it hurts. And you couldn't say this about any other minority group. And besides, women are not a minority. They're 51% of humanity, but we're a minority group in terms of representation. And, you know, you would say this about any other minority group and you would be in huge trouble, you know, but you can say about us that we lack ambition and get away with it, and I'm outraged by it.
It reminds me of that horrible headline article from earlier in the year. Do you know what I mean? Where they were talking about, I mean, I didn't even like to use the word, but ethnicity casting. You know, that was a ridiculous article too.
Yeah. Yeah, they were really complaining that people of color were getting too many roles in film and television.
Yeah, I don't even know if we should be talking about that, because I don't think we should give these people the time and space, because that was an utterly foolish thing to say. And I can't even believe that it's allowed to be present. Of course they are not taking over. It's ridiculous. There's one show on the black people. The rest is a little whitewashed. Russell Crowe is coming out in a new movie that's whitewashing the Armenian genocide. That's after he's in the other whitewashing movie where he played somebody in the Bible, which everybody's in the Bible, you know, from the Middle East. I don't know how all these white people got in there. Well, it's true. There was no, I mean, it's like the biggest miracle in modern day Christianity is that Jesus, who was born a Palestinian, suddenly turned into a blonde and blue-eyed dude.
Yeah, that's always been amusing to me. Like, yeah, sure, Moses was also white.
And then who was? In Exodus, everybody had the eyeliner.
It's definitely ridiculous. In another interview on this episode, we spoke to two women who were predominantly in the independent stage, and when asked about why they were in that space, they said that they were actually able to write their own narratives.
It's not true, though. Let's forget that completely. Women try all the time. We don't make money in independent films. We in America, we don't make money in independent films. You actually cannot make a living. I know, because I started in independent films. We all want to move into the mainstream. That's the goal of making an indie film, is to get picked up and get put in one of the studio films. But we don't get picked up. This only works for guys. Guys go from the most obscure films to doing Jurassic Park, Godzilla, Spider-Man. And yet, you know, this doesn't work for any of the winners that, you know, looked at what Granix Winger's bone. I'm amazed that she's not on every movie that's out there, but it just simply doesn't work for us. And by saying that, well, independent works for me because I can write my own narrative, it sometimes makes me a little upset that women actually continue to tell this tale, because what it really does is it ghettoizes us. It's like telling women who want to own a restaurant that they only allowed to own food trucks, that restaurants are for men. You know, we should be part of this industry. There is an existing industry, and we're shut out. To say that, it's better for us in independent, that's women lying to themselves and trying to make their situation not as miserable as it really is. Nobody chooses to be in such a hard job, not making money. We all want to be in that industry that actually sends us a paycheck.
Honestly, a paycheck is probably why women continue answering sexist casting calls.
I don't blame the girls who go, to be honest, because, you know, look, it's incredibly, incredibly hard to become an actress. You do all kinds of stuff for that, and I think what's more important is, like, why is this out there? And you know why these young guys do these kind of short films? Because they see that it's popular. They see what people are laughing about, what movies get greenlit. So when they choose to do these shorts, not because they think they get rejected, it's because they think they will make a bunch of people love them and like them and laugh. I remember this, a guy got Harold and Kumar from a short film, and I thought, oh, I can see this, like, who got a major movie from a short film? And the short film was Michelle Rodriguez and a couple of other women in slow motion and basically shorts and not much else, I mean a bikini, basically in slow motion pillow fight. That's the short film that got him a major movie. You know, the dudes are doing what they think can get them in, and the girls are doing what they think can get them in. And unfortunately, that's the system we have. The young people are just doing what we're telling them to do. If that kind of short film would make a bunch of people think, oh, you disgusting pig, we'd never hire you. Do you think a guy would do a short film like that? No. It has to massively change, and this talent has to grow a conscience. And it can't just only be women saying, oh, we think this is sexist, da, da, da. It's like people have to go on the streets and think, we don't want this for our sons nor our daughters. We don't want it for us if we're childless. We don't want it for humanity.
You know, when you have the viewing figures there, and when people are going out to the cinema to watch the few female-fronted films, those numbers speak, and they translate to money to the investors who should be getting behind them. So, yes, it should come from the industry, but if the general public can support the films and turn out the films that we need them to, then that goes a long way to helping.
I also think we have to boycott some of the other films. Like, I think people don't learn from positive as quickly as from negative when it comes to corporations. You know, Black Twitter has been very successful shutting down some stuff, you know, that was either racist or whitewashing, because they stuck together and amplified their voice. And I have so much admiration for that. And I think we have to do that as women and just as people on the right side. But instead of just doing it positive, which I think that's important, we have to turn up. We also have to, you know, make noise and say we will not watch a certain show that doesn't hire women, or we will not buy a product that has a sexist commercial. We really have to, like, you know, make it known that we, our consumer money does not go into sexism or racism or exclusionism.
Up until now, it feels like people have been telling lots of stories, but people need to see the stats to get engaged, to understand the scale of it. People respond much better to statistics than they do to individual stories, because you can isolate an individual story.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree. But I also think we have kind of like statistics fatigue. Like, right now, nothing shocks us anymore. The statistics, the stats are getting worse every year. And I think it's just white noise, whereas the women in the trenches are horrified. But I think outside, like, I haven't seen anything from somebody outside the industry, or even somebody not affected, that's actually making some noise, because it's literally become white noise. So I think it's really up to us. I mean, women in history had to hit the streets to make change, and I think if this is important enough for us, we do have to hit the streets as well.
Well, that was depressing. Thank you to these wonderful ladies for speaking so honestly about the roadblocks women face in the entertainment industry.
Women definitely get the short end of the stick.
They have to fight for the short end of the stick.
Women are lucky to get the food truck, honestly. Here's to things getting better in the future. I think it's important that we keep talking about it.
Yeah, definitely. Dialogue is key to progress. I dream of a world where an entire site dedicated to sexist casting calls is not necessary.
So guys, what are your thoughts? Tweet us at The Exposé Show.
And look out for our next episode on June 3rd, where we continue to rip the band-aid off the real issues. In this episode, we heard Digital Witness by St. Vincent, Had $10 by Cherry Glazer, Pocket Knife by PJ Harvey, and Real Real by Sleigh Bells, which we're going to close with. Follow our playlist on Spotify to keep up with the great music we feature. The Exposé is produced by Siddiq Ashraf, Varisha Khan, Cheyenne Farouk, Kanza Khan, and me, Leila Alawa. You can find out more about the show at comingoffaith.com/podcast.
The Exposé is brought to you by Coming of Faith. It's a digital media venture amplifying the voices of minority women. You can share your episode ideas with us by emailing stories@comingoffaith.com or tweet us. We come out with new episodes on the first Wednesday of every month, so join us on June 3rd for more frank discussions and kick-ass tunes. See you guys then. What about them? I'm all about them. 6 sets straight A's, cut them in the bathroom.